and you've gone through something or other, and you just kick it in. And you don't do this until a relationship is built up among everybody, and there's a tremendous commitment there. You just dissolve meetings of all kinds. And you say, for the next some odd weeks, we're not going to meet. Or, you'll hear from us when you hear from us. There will be a meeting someday, we don't know when. And about 2 weeks will pass, and you'll hear about a meeting. Something. The singles got together with their guitars and sat around and fellowship and had a glorious time. And everybody thinks, well, they did. They did. Tell us about it. What's going on? And I don't care how great we are, it seems that meetings take on a meeting atmosphere. But when you cancel all meetings, then people can really have meetings. Did you follow that? And they're totally spontaneous. I don't even care if they're cliquish. I don't care if it's just the single sisters meeting or just the single brothers and sisters or just the married sisters getting together. But those things that are put together by people who just are hungry for fellowship are unclassifiable and among the most wonderful meetings, or at least some of the neatest meetings you and I will ever attend. That's one of the best meetings of all, and there is nothing so wonderful as knowing that next Sunday or Saturday or Monday or Friday you are totally without any obligation to meet. And a question rises, and that is, how does the church meet its finances when there are no meetings? And the answer is, brothers and sisters will go out of their way to find the offering box to give because they love her. They have by now fallen head over heels in love with this girl, and they're going to take care of her.
Let me tell you how to kill a church. Kill its meetings. Have a choir. You want to hear another way? Have a orchestra or band. I'm going to tell a story. They had a band, and they had these huge, great big amplifiers, and I spoke. And man, I'll tell you, that band up there was a singing and giving it all. I thought that was the greatest singing church I ever saw or heard in my life. When I got through speaking, I said, let's stand up and sing. And I said, what are you going to sing? And we started the song. I started to lead it. And I made a startling discovery. Maybe they did too. Those people out there in the audience did not know how to sing and were not singing. It was all coming over that loudspeaker from that band, and the rest of the people had long since ceased singing. They were just up there mouthing something. And in Portland, one of the brothers in our fellowship attended a Pentecostal church with one of these big bands, and one day the whole amplification system burned out, and he said, I was astonished to find out that church did not have the foggiest idea how to sing. We had been listening to a band sing and thought we had been listening to a church sing. And I'll say something y'all may not know about the brothers and sisters from Illinois. They don't ever get together like that under normal conditions, all in one spot or in a corner. They scatter out throughout the meeting place. It was wonderful to see those people. Half of the people in the meeting of their fellowship have some sort of an instrument that they carry in the meeting. You say, well, it must be a tambourine. Listen, they have stuff in there I've never seen before. And will never see it again. Did you see that strange-looking contraption? This brother had it. Was round. It looked like the inside unit of a thermos bottle. And he had they told me he made this thing. He had a rub board in one place and some little dots in another place and some bigger rub board in another place. He had a little thing. He raked across different parts, and he'd turn that round bottle, and he would beat on it, or he would scrape on it, or he would do something else with it. He could get more different sounds out of that one thing. And he'd sing and do that, and you wouldn't believe it. Somebody else had sticks. They'd just stand there with a stick and beat on it. And somebody else had, I know they didn't have any castanets, did they? What were some of the other things they had? They had the Congo drum. They had all sorts of little things I had never seen before scattered around the room. That's great. Wonderful. But get rid of your band. I think a church needs to start a cappella. I really do. Now, I have something to say to you. And this is just so simple, it's so revolutionary. If I ever get to Atlanta, brother, God willing, if I ever get to Atlanta, if there are actually people here, we're just going to take our good, easy time about when we start meeting. And one of the things we're going to do, and I recommend it to everybody, and that's what one of the things we're going to do next summer, if you come, turn the entire church into a choir.
Amen.
Turn the church into a choir. Have a night in which you put the altos and the sopranos and the basses and the, I don't know how you do this, the baritones and the tenors, break them up and put them in place and then learn a song together that way. And I'll tell you exactly what song we're going to learn next summer together. We're going to start off with a Hallelujah Chorus. But you do not sing the Hallelujah Chorus to get to glory. You sing the Hallelujah Chorus to express the glory that you have touched. I'm going to drive that home again and again and again. We don't come to a meeting to get. We come to a meeting to give. Our giving is with the Lord alone or with one or two or three other people, sometimes not in the meeting. Well, it's a matter of just your imagination from that point on. Get rid of the choir and turn the church into a choir. Have a songbook and don't ever have a songbook. Have it to grow, have it to add to, have it to memorize, have it to use at home, have it to learn some of the numbers, but either don't bring it to a meeting or if you do, don't use it in the meeting. Now, I'm going to quit there.
If you don't have anything to give, you stay home?
Yeah, that's your punishment. I would really recommend you don't come. Punish yourself.
Is it okay?
I didn't mean that. So one other thing about a meeting, that is, one of the most wonderful things about a meeting, which no preaching and no pastors and no leaders, and when everything is dependent on that which happens outside the meeting, you find out how dead the church is, or how alive she is. A Baptist church, if you graph its meetings, they always are just like that. That was the revival and all that. Did you see that? What you need me to do that again?
Was that a one-week revival?
That was a one-week revival. Did you see it? There it was. All right. Now then, the church isn't like that. The church like this. No Baptist church has ever had a meeting as dead as Christians meeting without any human headship can have. They reach lower, deeper, better depths than any other thing known to mankind. It is at that time you stop and start taking inventory about what to do about this. You must spend the rest of your life taking care of meetings. They will be a large part of the energy of the church. And you don't know what I'm talking about. And this is a lesson that has to be learned. Hey, listen, if you have 12, 15, or 20 meetings per year, that's good enough. The rest of the time ought to be spent preparing for them. And you will not do that. You'll go ahead, boy, it's glorious, and you'll have about 10 in a row. And I wouldn't give you 10 cents for the 10th one. And you wouldn't either. But you'll go ahead and have the 11th and the 12th. And I don't understand you. I don't understand. Why don't you blow the whistle and stop and say, it's time we took a different direction and took a whole new way of meeting. Why don't you stop when your meetings get all the sameness in them? Why do you think a church has to meet? What addiction, what angel told you that a church has to keep meeting when death has arrived? Why not stop and start over again? Take a new look at your morning. Take a new look at your meetings. There are other ways to meet. There are other things to do besides meeting. There are other things. Maybe it's time to evangelize. Maybe it's time to fast. Maybe it's time to send somebody out to the foreign mission fields like Hawaii. Yeah. You know, Maybe it's time for the church to take a total, absolute vacation. August is a great time to have nothing. And absolutely shut down everything and everybody. Leave and go to a conference, a Christian conference somewhere where Gene Edwards is speaking. Shut it down. Don't keep on with all this dead stuff. Maybe it's time to turn the church back into a choir and learn some new songs. But I'll tell you this. Somewhere, you're going to have to come back to the engine of your faith, the Lord Jesus Christ. Watch for a series of dead meetings. It is time to quit and do something else. Now, tomorrow, we're going to have to talk about where all this is going to come from. Get your notes out real quick and start reading. It's divine. What else? Very real, it's organic. You got anything else?
Place where Christ feels at home.
It's a place where Christ feels perfectly relaxed and at home.
Living.
It's living. And sometimes she's beautiful. She's a girl. I don't think we wrote that down. Put that in your notes. She's a girl. She's a she. She's an organism, not an organization, and you should not organize her. She has her own natural expression. I said something else about what she is by nature. She's a colony out of heaven, and is the one heavenly thing that is on this earth, the other realm thing that's on this earth, and she should respect that. For you and for me, she is our civilization. She is, in fact, our habitat. She is where we live. Many of you have heard me say it before, but what school is to fish, what a flock is to sheep, what a covey is to quails, what a herd is to cattle, and what civilization is to fallen man, ecclesia is to the redeemed. And therefore, something in me gets really rebellious when I think that everything Christians do today that's fun is outside the church, and everything that's boring is in the church. Therefore, something's wrong with our concept of church. And that's what we've been handling and dealing with all this week. All right, what's the expression of the church? Did we talk about that, didn't we? The expression? What's the purpose of gathering? That's what it was. What? I'm sorry, Ben? To display the bride of Christ? And what? Go ahead and say what? Okay, we meet before angels. Every time we gather before angels. Alright, I didn't ever think about that. To show the beauty of the Lord's wife. Or at least his girlfriend, his fiance, his bride. Okay? To make Jesus Christ visible, we are his body, and to make him visible. Okay, did we say anything else about the purpose? To shame the principalities and powers, to prove that Jesus Christ himself can come invisibly upon this earth and guide his people. What the Father is to the Son is to the church. Jesus lived on this earth, heard his Father speak, listened to his Father, obeyed his Father, followed his Father, and demonstrated and made his Father visible. The church, when it gathers, and it is in its gathering, when all the pieces and the parts, the body parts are assembled, and we are doing what Christ did. When in his relationship to the Father is passed on to us, we are showing that he can be heard, felt, responded to, loved, and made visible on this earth. And that if the Father was the head of Jesus Christ, and was his Lord, and his King, and if you please, his dictator, and the one who told him what to do and what to say, when the church gathers, she does the same thing. He is her Lord, he speaks, she obeys. A meeting is to demonstrate the headship of Jesus Christ. There ought not to be human leaders at a meeting. Fred Malir, and I have a little common background, so I'll say something that Fred will appreciate. A meeting is not a place where a bunch of people walk in the briefcases and sit down on the front row and start the meeting. and then turn around like a bunch of turkey gobblers and watch what everybody's doing. You know what I'm talking about, Fred? All right. The brethren do that. If you've ever been in a brethren meeting, the leaders will always more or less march in, sit down on the front row. You know that, the Bible and briefcase, and man, I mean, you're intimidated from day one. And of course, in the religious system, none of that. You got your bulletin, this all, and the pastor has decided it. But I would say in the beginning and the birth of the church, he who leads, who builds, who lays the foundation ought not to be present in those meetings in which you're seeking to tear down old ways. There ought not to be anybody present who is considered a leader. And let the strong say they are weak. Not the weak say they are strong. But let those who are aggressive sit back. And let the timid be the ones who lead out. Now, we got responsibilities and meetings that I cannot possibly this weekend touch upon. So I'm going to say a couple of things that will be very disappointing to you. I'm going to tell you a few of the problems with meetings in which you seek to have no leadership, human leadership, and follow the Lord. One of the problems is that most of us don't know how to follow the Lord in a meeting. And the best we can do is just stumble around with one foot in a glue pot. And it takes a long time to get sensitive to the Lord. It will take literally years. But it is a wonderful thing when you do. But there is always, and this is my point, there is always someone who never catches on. You can be in the middle of a glorious meeting that you really sense the Lord has head off. He's not only being magnified, but he is leading that meeting. And I have likened it unto, could you imagine you're standing in the middle of the experience of the Lord's second coming, and the angels have become visible, and here the heavenly host is gathering, and all the redeemed of past, present, past and present are coming, and there is the Lord in his glory. It is the most magnificent moment of all time. And about that time, someone walks by hollering, peanuts, popcorn, peanuts, popcorn. Anybody want some peanuts, popcorn? Anybody want a program? Can't tell what's going on with our program. And you have this human being who just messes up everything royally. He or she, and it's a female as often as it is a male, just doesn't seem to have any sensitivity to the Lord. Here you are, you're all on your knees. You're all praising the Lord. Glory is abounding. The songs all fit. Each one of them tells another story. Everything is just going on and on, and someone says, let's sing Do Lord. And I'll tell you your first urge. Your urge is to kill. And this person will be this way all the rest of their life, now and forever, world without end. You're going to have to live with him or her. And that's why I'm saying to you, only rarely will you be in a meeting in which from beginning to end the Lord has full headship. I'm sad to tell you that, but it's true. I will tell you that there will be people who will desert leadership in meetings, and you really know that they shouldn't. That's another problem. And I'm going to tell you something else. If I'm present in a meeting, I'm warning you now, if I'm present in a meeting, and if it's not going well, I will step in and change it. And you might dislike me, but I'm not there so much to be part of a meeting. Now, that's not always true, but it's a possibility if I'm present. I'm there to train, to educate, to lead you, to show you something higher or better. And you're going to have to excuse me for being that way, but I am extra local, and I will leave in a few days, and you'll be lit up with me. I'm not like that guy who sells peanuts and popcorn, and you're stuck with him forever. Songs that are out of place. Testimonies around time. Everybody's having this wonderful time of sharing about the Lord, and someone says, well, I think this is the right time. Or they'll often say, I'm not sure what I'm doing is correct, but I'm going to do it anyway. That's a sure sign you're in trouble. And they decide to get up and tell the church how ugly it's treated them. And you have to sit there and bear that. And it's totally out of order.
But it's there. Another one is, I don't like you. You just made half the gray hairs in my head. And I don't know what to do with you. You don't know how to stop talking. And one person always comes to mind. I've seen dozens of them like this, but one person comes to mind. It was a girl. She ended every sentence with "and." She did, I'm telling you. The Lord showed me such and such and such and such, and she had no idea what she was going to say. There'd be this long pause, and then she'd say something else. Mm-hmm. This girl would sometimes talk for 20, 30, or 40 minutes, mm-hmm. and every sentence ended with an "and." She could not finish. She could not quit. By the way, one of the most interesting things about that situation was she had a lot of other problems too. She was with us 3 or 4 years. She sold more peanuts and popcorn at this Lord's second coming than anyone else in the church. The day that I finally sat down with her after years and years and years and years of chaos and trouble and pain she brought to the church, first time she was ever confronted, and it was as gentle as I know how, and I can be very, very gentle. In fact, she did most of what was said and done that day. That day she packed her bags and left. And I always think of that, that the church was for her a platform. Mm-hmm. You understand what I'm saying? It was a place for that person to do. Mm-hmm. And we'll have that kind of person always in the church. Sometimes you'll be a very arrogant human being. I know you know a few of these folks, but they feel the whole world centers in them. And their sharing is always got a self-centered attitude, an element to it. It's just you have that forever. I made a decision early in my ministry, and that was that at least for the first 15 or 20 years, until the younger ones became older men in their 40s, I was never going to let anyone see me angry, confrontive, judgmental, critical, adjusted, rebuking, anything negative. I was going to demonstrate to them patience and force patience on them, because that's a lot more difficult than confrontation. Yeah. And also, once you confront someone, there is someone, there is not one, but many people in your meeting who will use confrontation then. Now, if I do something once, there's a saint back there somewhere who's just inclined that way. Mm-hmm. And once they see it, they have license from that day and forevermore to do that. I will give you a recent example out of my own life. For the first time in my ministry, from the day I was called to preach at the age of 18 until I was 55 years old, about 4 or 5 months ago, something happened that got to me. I got hurt. Hurt bad enough that I brought it to the church. Boy, there were brothers who'd waited 20 years to see me do that. 20 years they waited to have license. And the day they saw me vulnerable and weak, all sorts of problems broke out. I don't know if you understand what I'm talking about, but I know my responsibility as a minister of the gospel is to not be refusive, rebukative, and confrontive. Or if I do, I'm going to come back and find a church full of rebukers and confronters. Now, on the other hand, Babs, I envy you. That's one side. On the other hand, I envy you, because I wanted to correct, exhort, adjust people so many times, and I just haven't and haven't and haven't. I have to get pressed to the wall before I'll lean forward on somebody and say, "Thou ailest here, here, and here." And we had a fellow who came and joined us, and we knew something was wrong, we knew something was wrong, and we knew something was wrong, and something was wrong. And finally, the word came to us that God had sent him to us to lead us. And God had told him that he would be the leader of our group. And that's what was wrong. He was, when these strange testimonies were coming, they weren't testimonies, they were orders. And of course, he being a very unusual person. We couldn't catch on to that. It was just declaration, rebuke, and he was actually functioning as religion. I sicked two brothers on him, being the coward that I am. And that's a pretty serious matter, and he was an older man, too. I'm very reluctant to speak to you. I'm reluctant to correct. I'll be happy to tell you my method. Rather than do that, I will have the church in a meeting. There are other ways to skin a cat besides doing it with a rusty spoon. I have the church to vote on who they want to blow the whistle on people who, and it becomes a fun thing. This person is going to correct or stop or whatever, and the church chooses someone to do that in the meeting, and that person actually does it, and it goes over really well. And by the way, I recommend that. I don't recommend it the first meeting particularly, but I recommend it because it will be there. And I think, and let me hang this little hook here and come back to it later. I think, brothers and sisters, if you're going to have meetings of such a radical nature as I have described, then I think that you have to do a lot of discussing about those meetings at other times and discuss the problems that are coming up in them. And as I said to you last night, to be aware when they start getting dead and dry and to do something about it. But that's one of the things. When someone is over-functioning, to illustrate it, my whole body is functioning, but obviously some part of my body has gotten to over-function, and that's what happens to the Lord's body. We get somebody, one of the members is just over-functioning. I would say generally, unless you've got a very sick situation in the church, which should be very rare, that need not ever happen. Now, I'm going to give you a cure for it. Now, the cure has itself problems, as all cures do. There are side effects. For years, now it's part of a hallmark of my own ministry, and I'm not telling you you ought to do this, but I wouldn't know how to do what I do without it. I would not know how to function without this. We never have Sunday morning meetings. I mean, we have had, and they're always horrible. There's just something cursed about 11 a.m. or something. I mean, it's true, that's just, it doesn't matter. You can meet at 11 a.m. any day of the week, except Sunday morning. And something will happen. And we don't have Sunday morning. I'm not ever going to have Sunday morning meetings. We've been confronted with it, tried it for 2 or 3 months, even recently. I just want to be part of it. I won't be there. I'm not going to put up with it. I'm not going to live in that kind of atmosphere. I can't stand it. But anyway, what we do instead is have brothers' meetings every Sunday. And we dump it all out there. But now to have a situation like that, you've got to have someone who feels very, very secure in what he's doing. Not everybody is that secure. And I mean, we have it. And there's no time for murmuring out in the middle of the week. We all murmur on Sundays, and that's one of the things we do is talk about our meetings and where they are and what they're doing. Now, then, there are times, brother, I have to admit that murmuring can take place outside, when, even if you have brothers' meetings every Sunday. But boy, when you got that, you got major problems in the church. I mean, you got major problems. You're probably facing a split. I mean, one of the problems with having brothers' meetings, and that's with all the brothers present, as the sisters are left out. So bring the sisters in. Well, the brothers don't act the same way. The kills the brothers' meeting just like that. So you have sisters' meetings. Well, the sisters could give a hoot.